program is brought to you in living color on NBC.
It's the Gilbert Gottfried Amazing Colossal Christmas Special. Join Gilbert and his special guests, Carol Channing, Hervé Villechaize, Charles Nelson Reilly, post-stroke Betty Davis, with Frank Santopadre and the Seth Saltzman Orchestra, and special guest star, Mario Cantone.
Hi, this is Gilbert Gottfried, and this is Gilbert Gottfried's Amazing Colossal Podcast. I'm here with my co-host, Frank Santopadre, and our engineer, Frank Verderosa. Well, it's beginning to look a lot like Christmas, and the man you've waited for all year long, no, not that fat hack Santa Claus, is back with us by popular demand. And boy, do we mean popular demand.
Is it that popular?
Yes.
Is it really?
Yes, it is.
I like hearing that. If it wasn't popular, I hope you'd have me anyway.
Let him get through this.
Right. I never let him get through it.
He's a Tony-nominated actor.
I am.
Yeah, that means you're heterosexual.
Yeah, that's exactly what it means. All Tony nominees are heterosexual.
Yes, yes.
They don't like the gays, Broadway.
Yes, you're... You're a total pussy, huh?
Yeah, and you know it.
That's the way to get pussy, is by going to
Absolutely.
The Tony
Award. I've been lying my whole life just to get laid, just to get pussy. I'm like, I'm gay. No, we want you. I can't do it. I don't think I'll be able to get it up. And then swing, swing, it goes up, it goes in the vag, and I get it.
Okay. He's a stand-up comedian.
Well, barely at this point.
A recovered kiddie show host, a pop culture historian, a gourmet baker, and one of the world's funniest, most versatile entertainers.
Yeah, yes, I am versatile.
Alive or dead?
Yes. Alive or dead?
True. Oh, God.
Yes.
Yes.
You've seen him in nightclubs, on a Broadway, and an off-Broadway stage, in dozens of television shows and popular feature films. You may have heard him on this very podcast.
Yes, you did, if you're listening.
A holiday fixture, one of our most requested and beloved guests. Here he is, folks, straight from his command private performance for Les Moonves.
They canceled my show because I wouldn't suck his dick.
You wouldn't suck someone's dick?
Get to the issue.
Not Les Moonves. What do you think, homos just suck any dick, Gilbert?
Yes.
I wouldn't suck your dick, so go fuck yourself. You're starting this off really nicely, you piece of shit, you Christmas fucking elf.
Our very own elf on a shelf. Mario Cantone.
I am an elf
Welcome.
On the show. I apologize already for being rude to you.
Back.
And verbally and slightly sexually abusing
so
you just now.
You wouldn't suck my dick?
No, I wouldn't suck your dick. I wouldn't suck anybody in this room's dick. I love you all, but I'm not going to do it.
Why?
Because I'm married, Gilbert Gottfried.
Hold on, I hate to interrupt this, but we this was going to happen later. But
so
we,
you're one of those queers who's loyal.
Gilbert, let me...
I am loyal. Yeah. I am loyal to the bone.
See, I always thought with the fags, they'll fuck anything.
Gilbert.
Well, we will... No, that's not true. We'll fuck... We are more discerning than you fucking heterosexual piece of shit. Oh, you will fuck anything with a slit. And I don't mean just on a woman. I mean anything. I mean, see that? You see that wall right there? That soundboard that's put together in three pieces? You take that second and third piece, pull it apart, and stick your dick in it. You piece of shit.
Gilbert, I'm going to interrupt because we have a special caller.
Yes.
Oh,
okay.
Who
on
is
the
it?
Line. Did
we, do?
Did we lose him?
We lost him because of that.
All right, well, because we were talking about vagin.
Yes, I was trying to get to him faster.
Well, what are you going to do? Maybe he'll call back.
No, I don't think so. He was on a plane that was taking off.
How do you do a phone call with someone that's ready to take off on a plane? You're a horrible producer. Oh, my God. I have never worked with such unprofessionals in my goddamn life.
If you were on a plane
yes.
and the pilot said to you, I'm going to crash into a mountain if you don't suck my dick.
I would suck his dick. But I would have fear of flying through the whole thing. It doesn't take that away. Did you hear about that guy, that kid that was on Grindr, and he said the pilot was on Grindr too, and he grinded him from the cockpit? And then, meanwhile, they showed a picture of the pilot. This guy's like exposing the pilot, telling him that he's grind. You're both on Grindr, so why are you making this public? Then the pilot is gorgeous. I'm like, what a fucking asshole this guy was. Not the pilot. The other kid. All right, continue. Just edit that out.
Welcome back.
It's really nice to be here. Get off your cocksucking phone.
I'm setting the timer.
Oh, you are?
Yes, I time the show.
Oh, well, I don't like
Someone
that.
Has to do it.
I don't like timer. Don't tell me to wrap it up. Let's go. Yes. Okay.
Well, the caller who was going to call in has taken off on a plane.
Oh, what is so
he? What would he have said had he called?
He would have said, I'm going to Amsterdam to smoke lots of pot. Leave me alone. No,
You have to imagine the setting for just a minute.
Yeah.
He's on a plane about to take off, holding a phone on speaker
yeah.
with the conversation you guys were just having with a crowded airplane.
Oh, I know. I know what it was going to be.
It was Richard Kine.
Yeah, we were going to discuss the bullshit Mr. Magoo special. Yeah. Oh,
I'm
I know.
I'm emailing him. To tell him he can chime back in once he's at altitude and he gets Wi-Fi.
Great.
Oh, let's talk to him while he's up in the air. I can't wait.
So everybody that was on his plane just got to hear that dialogue?
Probably.
Which is amazing. I think he was trying to cover the phone as fast as he could.
It's the friendly skies.
I'll say. It's the filthy skies of United.
We have to talk about the recent Rudolph controversy.
Well, first of all, who's been saying it for years?
Yeah, you have.
I've been saying it
since...
Well,
I've been saying that, too.
That he was gay?
I always said what I hated about that story... is that they were fucking pricks to Rudolph.
Yes, of course.
And then when they realize they can use him, then he's okay.
That's the end of my bit, Gilbert. Just keep stealing from each other. to rise, and climb up the ladder. You're right. That's the truth. Yeah. I say that. I call Santa a fat fuck. He's a fat fuck. Because you know what? He says to Donner, the coach, who's like, Mom, you're right. Let's see Rudolph fly. You know that piece.
He talks like Edward Sheeran.
Yeah, he does. He's like, right. Come on, kids. Come on, let's play a reindeer game. Right. He does that. Yeah. So when he takes off, Rudolph, and then he comes down and the hoof hits him and the nose is exposed like he got a hard on in the shower in gym class. It's all symbolic. And then Santa says, that's too bad. He had a good takeoff too. And it's like, so he still didn't have a good takeoff just because he's Rudolph the same-sex reindeer? I mean, I don't understand why. And then at the end, he's brutal to him.
Yeah.
Awful. And then at the end, he's like, Rudolph with your nose so bright. And I said, if I was Rudolph, I would have been like, you know what, Santa? You humiliated me my whole life. Crash and burn! Fat fuck!
Now, if Santa Claus said he'd bring you extra nice toys, would you blow him?
No, I won't, because I'll buy my own toys. Let me tell you what's going to be on my gravestone, Gilbert.
This would be
on my gravestone. I can buy the whore. I can't be one.
Gilbert, just because you'd blow Santa for some free toys doesn't mean Mario.
You know what? Gilbert would blow Santa for the fluffy towels at the Marriott Motel that he stays in every time he fucking travels.
You saw the documentary? Did you see the documentary?
No, I can't bear it. I have not seen it yet because I don't want to see him treating himself like a piece of shit everywhere. Why don't you book a fucking 5-star, you piece of shit, you cheap bastard? Oh, I'm having so much fun so far.
Oh, my God.
Yes. All right, what else?
Wait a minute. Richard Kind is texting. He says, I'm on a crowded plane. All they can hear, the passengers could hear, was Les Moonves sucked my dick.
Oh,
I'd suck your dick. I said to a guy across the aisle, can you hear this? He replied, the guy in the bathroom at the back of the plane could hear this. I'm sorry, guys. I had to hang up. I'm sorry. But Mario is still wrong.
You tell that piece. You text him right now and you ask him one question. Did it get a laugh? That's all I care about. Was the plane laughing? Cares about that.
I want him to pick up the phone again.
Yeah.
Okay. He's on a plane.
He's taking off. I'm not wasting my time with that.
I told him that if he gets to altitude and there's Wi-Fi, to join us again.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. If he gets to altitude and the air masks drop.
So you were way ahead of the curve on the Rudolph controversy for years.
And now all of a sudden, you know, it's It's I disagree with what they're saying, like that it's politically incorrect and
it promotes bullying.
They miss
the point entirely.
It doesn't promote bullying. That's all you care about is him.
Yes.
And as a young homosexual, I related to it because the poor guy was bullied his whole life. I was bullied, but you know what? Let me tell you about bullying stories. I just go like this: bull who, boo fucking who. Everybody gets bullied. Boo who. Toughen up. It's 2018. Toughen up. Everyone's coming out of the closet. John Travolta and Tom Cruise are right behind you. I promise it's going to happen.
Oh, my God. I hope I can get through this show.
I do, too.
Let's also just talk about something you and I talked on the phone, and it's current, which is the baby It's Cold Outside controversy.
You know.
Yes. Did you know about this, Gil?
Yes, I know. Can we play that? We sang it last week.
We had the definitive version. We really did. Okay. Yeah, it's Bette Davis and
Tony Curtis.
Did
you just tweet this?
I did. I retweeted it. And
I really can't stay.
But baby, it's cold outside.
I've got to go away.
But baby, it's cold outside.
It's the greatest thing ever.
This evening has been.
Been hoping you drop
so
in.
So very nice.
I'll hold your hands like they're just like ice.
My mother will start to worry.
Beautiful watch you wearing.
My father will be pacing the floor.
Listen to the fireplace roar.
So I really better scurry.
Beautiful, please don't hurry.
Well, maybe just a half a drink more.
Put some records on while
the
I pour.
The neighbors might think.
You threw off my rhythm so bad.
Oh, he's so behind.
Is in this drink.
You're so in the pocket, as they say. Jesus Christ.
Your eyes are like starlight now.
It's brilliant.
All right, that's
it's brilliant.
Yeah. It's very good.
Thank you. One of our greatest hits.
So that's a politically incorrect. That's committing a crime.
Well, it's ridiculous. First of all, Frank Lesser wrote that song for his wife, and they did it at parties. It wasn't even supposed to be. I mean,
never intended to be published, right?
No, it was. And either way, once it was, it's playful. People, it is such a sick time in this world, and everything is being skewered. A silly thing like this, that's when people look really ridiculous and stupid. Stupid!
Our friend Seth Saltzman is here.
They say it's predatory.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes, and so are you, but I still come here every year.
I want to introduce Seth, who's here, Gilbert.
Would you suck Frank Lester's dick?
Yes, I would.
Frank Lester.
And as I did it, I would sing If I Were a Bell from Guys and Dolls.
Right. Another show where they drink dulce de leches down in Havana.
They do. Yeah. So is that incorrect?
Is that incorrect? I don't know.
Seth is here on keyboards. I just want to ask Seth, too. You posted about Frank Lesser and about Baby It's Cold Outside.
Yes,
you had your own opinion about the idea
that in the movie, after they became a great party song, they put it in the movie. Thing wins an Academy Award, mm-hmm. Best Song, 1949, from Neptune's Daughter.
Yes.
And the great part of it, they keep showing on TV the part with Ricardo Montalban.
That's right.
And Esther Williams. But the fun part is the second part with Red Skelton and Betty Garrett.
Betty Garrett.
Reversed the role. She won't let him out of the apartment.
They reverse it where Betty Garrett is predatory. She always played a predator, Betty Garrett. She was a predator in On the Town, too. Remember the song in the cab?
Yeah,
Come on to my place, that song.
Yeah.
She wouldn't let him out of the cab, Frank Sinatra. He was like dying.
So it was banned?
He was like, where's Ava Gardner? I can't fuck this chick.
The song was banned by radio stations in Cleveland and San Francisco.
Oh, please.
San
Francisco?
Yeah, can you believe that? Frank Lesser's daughter, Gilbert, you'll love this. She was asked to comment and she blamed it on Bill Cosby.
Well, that's...
Because
it's what's in this drink.
It's what's in this drink.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What's in this drink? It's because she's drinking too much. I don't know.
But they did it. It's true, right? It was something they did at parties. He never had any intention.
Yes.
Isn't that what you posted?
Yeah, and in the movie, too, the Esther Williams character, you could see she clearly wants to stay, and the lyrics are simply about, what will my mother say?
Because you can't just take it lyrically. You have to go to the origin of it, how it was played, how it was meant to be played. You know, I mean... You know, if Bill Cosby and Janis Dickerson played it, sang it together, it would be a little different.
Frank Lesser also wrote a song called The Secretary Is Not a Toy from...
Oh, that's right.
Right. So, I mean, he wrote songs and they were of their time. And
Everything is of its time. That's what we have to remember.
Oh, my God.
What?
I saw something where they were doing a production of How to Succeed in Business. Yep. And there was some song. Maybe it's the...
It might have been that.
Or a song about a girl singing that she has to have a guy in her life. And so they put in, they directed the other actors to make faces behind her to show that they disapprove this attitude.
Stupid. Yeah, that's good. That'll fix it. Make faces. Make faces and, you know... Put your thumb on your nose, and that's a great
idea. What have you been up to? Let's catch up with you briefly before we do all Christmas.
I've been doing celebrity autobiography on Broadway.
Oh,
which has been
with
very
Alec
fun.
Baldwin and some other people.
Alec Baldwin, Tony Danza. it's been fun. I did that for three Mondays in a row. With
whose biography did you?
I do Kathleen Turner's. I am fucking exhausted. I have to take the bus up and down Ninth Avenue. And everyone knows me, you know, the bus driver opens the door and says, Kathleen, you're looking good. And I say, I feel terrific.
I love that impression.
Now she came out with that interview recently where now she hates everybody.
Well, yeah, I don't know
she's
about everybody.
Outspoken.
You certainly make very broad strokes,
yes.
Don't you? For statements, Gilbert Gottfried. Yeah, she hates everybody. She mentioned me, you, Frank.
I'm so flattered.
I think, it was a great interview, actually.
Yes.
It really was. I love Kathleen Turner. I think she's one of the last of the great Broadway stars, too.
She'd be good for us here because she is a bit of a loose
cannon. Oh, God, you should absolutely have her here.
Yeah.
She's like, Gilbert, shut up and let me speak. I can't get a word in edgewise. I wouldn't fuck you with your wife's dick. I wouldn't do it. All right.
And you were on some game shows. I saw you on Match Game. You're doing that. Also with Alec Baldwin.
Yep.
You guys must be thick as thieves at this point.
I love him. He's a
would
big champion.
Would you blow Alec Baldwin?
Yes, I would.
Yeah.
for actually no money.
Okay.
Not even
a
job.
How about Billy?
Billy Baldwin? he was in Sliver, absolutely. But now, no.
Now, what about that Republican
Steven,
one?
We don't have time to
when
go through all the
when he was in Threesome, yes. But not now. He's a fat fuck.
Oh,
now.
And who's the craziest Baldwin?
Daniel.
The older
Daniel.
Brother, I don't know him. I can't say, but, you know, he does get a lot of press.
Did you see this, too? Mario, this made me think of you, and it's not actually Christmas-related. There's a new book coming out about The Wizard of Oz called The Road to Oz.
And what is this
by
now?
Jay Scarfone and William Stillman.
They didn't like the Yellow Brick Road because it smelled like urine? What's the problem?
This is interesting. This was in the Daily Mail, so you know it must be true.
Yeah.
Wizard of Oz bosses, you know about this, worried that Judy Garland wasn't right for Dorothy because of her large breasts and snaggletooth. This says,
fuck them. She's not Jewel.
I know. I'm reading this because I know Gilbert will love it. The real problem was mean, drunk, and smelly munchkins.
Yes. Oh, yeah. I know all about
and
this.
Two of them had to be bailed out for prostitution.
Oh, no. They put them. Judy told a story about it. She said that they put them all in a large house together. They all the munchkins, and they had parties, and they would kick you in the shins and trash the whole house and break tables and chairs, and they had to catch them with butterfly nets.
Yes, we've heard
Chevy,
that.
Chevy Chase was on this show because he did that
Under the Rainbow.
Under the Rainbow, where he had the munchkins there, a lot of the original munchkins, and he said they would grab the actors' asses and they walk around farting. They liked farting.
Yeah, they did. They were brutal. They were Judy Garland, and you know who was originally supposed to play that role? Shirley B. Mayer wanted
Shirley Temple.
Which would have been. We're over the rainbow. I mean, I can't picture it.
I can't either. Despite the fuss over Judy's appearance, the real issue during filming was with the little people, Gilbert, cast as munchkins. They were mean. They smelled from sweat as well as liquor, and some engaged in prostitution.
Gilbert was one of the ones that came out of the egg.
Yes. He was. He was.
And according to Hollywood legend, one of the munchkins hung himself.
Yeah.
And you could see him hanging from the tree.
Yep. That's a myth.
I can't imagine they didn't yell, cut, and say, get him down before we finish
the shot.
Well,
they were behind schedule.
Yeah, that was
reasonable.
They were behind schedule. The Munchkins were unruly.
Keep shooting.
Yep, keep shooting.
Did she have to wear a corset or something?
They put her in a contraption of some kind? They kind of taped down her breasts.
And is that where she got really heavily into drugs, where they were had to put her to sleep and then wake her up?
Well, she was conditioned. They conditioned Judy Garland. They put her to sleep with pills and they woke her up because they gave her like speed because they wanted her to lose weight. And that's why they, and then they had to give her a pill to go to sleep and then give her a pill to wake her up. Let me tell you something. She was a victim of all this shit. I mean, now it's like,
yes,
you know,
she was.
You look at people that are doing this today or even, you know, a couple of decades ago, it's like, you have to handle this yourself. I think with her, it was a different situation.
What a hard worker, though, and a body of work.
She was the greatest thing. Now, did you see the newest Star Is Born?
Haven't seen it yet.
No.
All right, we won't talk about it. No, I liked it, but it's not, you know, Judy Garland. But it was good. It was very good. I thought it was very good.
Now, generally, fags don't like Judy Garland, huh?
Yes, we do, you big fucking whore. And we are proud of it. Proud of it! Okay.
Now, do you like her better than Cher?
Yes. Oh, yes. Yes. But I just saw the Cher show.
Oh, how was the Cher show?
It was magnificent. Much better than I thought it was going to be. Okay. I don't like a jukebox musical. This was so smart and so well done because they hang it. They hang the whole premise on telling her life story through a variety show, which, you know, she had in her and Sonny.
What about Debbie Reynolds?
I love Debbie Reynolds. She died.
Yes.
Yeah, I loved it. I thought Debbie Reynolds was magnificent. Why are you asking me about Debbie Reynolds?
No, I think fags like Debbie Reynolds.
Yeah, but not as much as Judy Garland. Yeah.
Gilbert, do you like Debbie Reynolds?
No.
Debbie Reynolds one time came over and said she was a fan of mine.
There you go.
Really?
And then after she died, I thought, I should have asked her to be on the podcast.
You should.
Nice work.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow, that was a great guest.
He just lets them go like a slippery fish.
No, she came over to me at some event and said she was a fan.
Why would you not get her on the show? Gilbert!
Well, I wasn't doing this show at the time.
Didn't Carrie Fisher tell you she was attracted to you, that you were her type?
Carrie Fisher said to me at a roast, she said, "You are just my type." And I said, "What's your type?" And she goes, "Little, funny, and cute."
Well, you know, you do attract the mentally ill, so it's a nice thing. It's a nice thing for you. How your wife is as sane as she is.
She is a saint.
Oh,
the woman is going to be canonized.
Just book a Four Seasons once, just for your fucking wife.
That's reasonable.
Okay, so Cher, you like the Cher show?
I love it. Stephanie Block is magnificent. Okay. It's like, and Jason Moore directed it. It's pretty great. I have to say, I saw To Kill a Mockingbird. Outstanding. Outstanding.
Yep. I have tickets.
Outstanding. I saw Network. Bryan Cranston gives the performance of a lifetime.
He was just electric. Oh!
And Waverly Gallery is amazing. Elaine May is astounding.
How is Elaine May at her age?
Give her the Tony now.
How is she getting up and doing a show every night
in her
80s?
She's 85. It's like when 85. I saw Cicely Tyson in Trip to Bountiful and in the Gin Game. She was amazing. She was magnificent. Yeah.
Wow.
Bryan's going to get that Tony, Mr. Cranston.
And
Elaine May's going to get
people are raving about it.
Oh, it's astounding. It's unreal.
But I remember from seeing you in Laugh Whore that you were no fan of Moonstruck or Cher getting the Oscar for that role.
No, because I watch it again. I watch it again recently. I'm like, no, it's not Italian enough. It's not not that it's not Italian enough. It doesn't feel correct. It doesn't feel...
Very few Italians involved.
Well, Danny Aiello and Olympia Dukakis is Greek, but close enough. You know, she's magnificent in it. Nick Cage is fine.
Gardenia.
No. Oh, Vincent Gardenia. Right.
No, Vincent Gardenia.
Everybody else is a Jew or a Gentile or Irish
Catholic. That doesn't matter
to
me. It's more her performance that I just think, no, I don't buy it. Sorry. I love her, but I don't buy that performance.
Is that why you said, stab me in the head?
Oh, I said that. Cher has an Oscar.
She won the Oscar.
Yeah, I was like, put a knife in my temple right now.
That's another one of those movies that the happy ending is that the guy who's dating hot-looking young girls winds up with an old woman. That's very popular in Hollywood.
It really is popular. You know, those May-December romances. It's really not, though, because that's an older guy and a younger girl. They never make a deal about that. Don't you remember Moment by Moment with Lily Tomlin and John Travolta?
Oh, my God!
Where she was older and he was young.
Oh, my God, and was she, that song.
And his what name was reference. Strip. Strip. Oh, Strip. She was calling him on the phone and crying, Strip, no, I'm fine. I'm really okay. It was awesome. The worst movie.
That was
ever.
One of those nails in John Travolta's like, movie career before comeback.
He came back like most Scientologists
But the
do.
Movies I'm talking about are like, what was the one, you know, Jack Nicholson and Deborah Winger.
Deborah Winger
and Jack Nicholson.
In terms of endearment?
Oh,
terms
no,
of but,
endearment.
But they weren't a couple.
No, but he was going out with hot young girls.
Yep.
And
yep.
then he winds up with Shirley MacLaine,
yeah.
who's closer to his age,
yep.
and that's the happy Hollywood ending.
It is. Well, that's appropriate. That's right.
Well,
you
something's
know.
Gotta okay. give then, the same plot, where he's dating Amanda Peet, but he winds up with Diane Keaton.
Yes.
Same thing.
Oh, I love that movie.
Same formula.
Plot.
It's a fun,
it's
move, fun
it's a great movie.
Movie.
It really is. All right. I'm bored.
Okay, well, we were talking to Mario Cantone.
I gotta go.
About sucking cock.
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Would you guys like to try to guess some Christmas singers?
Yes, I do.
Okay, this will be fun. We'll stump you. We did it last year. We'll bring it back. Frankie, what do you got? Let's start in order. Some of them are easy. Some of them are hard. There's five of them.
Christmas, and all I could think about was
Jerry Lewis.
Yeah, no shit.
Yep.
Yeah.
Received. Yep.
Okay, that was a waste of time, Frank.
we're doing obscure, unheard of Christmas songs. I knew you were going to get Jerry, but they get harder.
Wow.
You know this, Gil?
No.
Wow.
Do you know it, Seth?
No, but I had a backstage experience with Jerry. About 6 months before he passed away, it was ugly.
Oh, what?
It was at the St. George Theater. Jerry was doing his one-man show just in the last year before he passed away.
Yeah.
And he sat on the middle of the stage. He was telling jokes, showing film clips, talking about the movies, telling some really bad jokes. It was an uncomfortable night because he just was not in great shape already. And the show was supposed to go about 2 hours. An hour in, Jerry, I think they were up to like Cinderella era. Not all the way through his career. And, and Jerry said, we're done. Good night. Everybody, like, the show's over. They're about 50 minutes. With my friend John, we were going to go backstage and say hi. But we go back to the stage door, and dishes are flying. Things are being broken backstage in the room.
Wow.
And poor Jerry is going out of his mind to the moment, like, I got to meet somebody else. I got to meet another person. It was so sad. So sad. So we did not go backstage.
Not the good Jerry.
We did
not. See, Gilbert, you always saw the good side of Jerry.
Yeah.
Well, I did that every night backstage at Laugh Whore. I threw dishes.
Oh.
I said, I got to meet another cocksucker. I can't do it.
That's exactly what was going on.
I bet.
There.
Oh, well, no. You know.
Oh, right, poor guy.
Well, I met him once. He was nice. He didn't like the homosexual, though. He didn't like the homosexuals.
Is that true?
I don't think he did.
Interesting.
No. I mean, it could be wrong, but I don't think he did. And no, Gilbert, I wouldn't suck his dick.
Yeah.
Gil,
why won't you suck my Kaffelwassenheimen?
Because it's the name of it is too long.
Yeah.
Gilbert, you don't know this song? I Had a Very Merry Christmas?
No.
By Jerry? I knew you'd know the voice. I was trying to stump you with the song. Okay, this one's a little harder.
Okay.
The second one.
I'm not looking at the screen.
Not that hard. Don't look at the screen.
The Partridge Family.
No. Mario will get it.
Put the loot in the boot, Santa. You've gotta be good to me.
Ah, yo, it's Mae West.
Very good.
Oh,
oh.
Very good.
Who is this?
Mae West.
It's Mae West. Oh, Frankie and Johnny.
Had you ever heard this one?
No, I haven't.
It's from Mae West. Mae West had a Christmas album called Wild Christmas.
Oh.
If you want to share my company.
Seth, you don't know it either.
No, this is new to me.
These are deep dives.
We're going to have to go get this on the way out.
She had a Christmas album in 1966, Wild Christmas.
Wow.
You got that fast.
Oh, I knew it was her right away.
Oh, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Oh, yeah. Got a very shiny nose. Oh, you're tickling me. Oh, let's do Silent Night. Silent Night, Holy Night. Oh, it wasn't too silent for too long. Oh, yeah.
I love her.
Let me get through a couple of these. Gilbert, this one's for you.
Yes.
See if you know who's singing or if you know the song. You might know the song.
I wonder
hippopotamus for Christmas. A hippopotamus is all I want. Don't want a doll, no dinky tinker toy. I want a hippopotamus to play with and enjoy.
Well, it's a group of men that can't sing, so let's let's narrow it down.
I don't think Santa Claus will mind you.
What do you think, Gil?
Well, yeah, it's a Jew.
Seth has a guess.
Alan Sherman?
No. You have a guess?
I saw the screen, so okay. I can't. But I wouldn't have known.
Gil, it's the Three Stooges.
Oh, my God. Oh, so that's what Curly Joe Dorita.
Curly Joe Dorita.
Wow.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Oh, Curly Joe. Yeah.
From 1953, so the song was written
he
was in 1953.
Really gay, wasn't
was he?
I don't
Joe
know.
Dorita?
Well, kind of. He was like, stop it. He did like.
Oh, that's Joe Besser.
Joe Besser.
Oh, all right.
Yeah. He played Stinky.
Yeah, Stinky.
I don't remember anything.
A song written in 1953, a Billboard hit for somebody called Gayla Peavy. Does that mean anything to you?
Gayla Peavy.
Yeah, she and
it was never a greatest hits.
It's been covered by Leanne Rimes, The Captain and Tennille, and Captain Kangaroo.
Do you know,
and that's
I
the Three
think,
Stooges version.
And I wow. think I've even heard it before.
You have?
Yeah.
Well, but not
makes,
that version.
It makes sense that, you know, Captain Kangaroo did it, but Captain and Tennille, that is from
yes.
left
and the
field.
Captain Kangaroo and Tennille, which was a failed, very failed.
Stooges
was,
had yeah. some nice harmony there.
Yeah, they did? That was Joe Dorita. Okay, here's another one.
And I can't look.
Don't look. This is from 1953.
It's over there. It's reflecting in the glass. I'm seeing it all over the place. It's like a nightmare.
Take your seats and all sit down. First, I start to sing the song, then you follow.
Was right that the guy who did Donald Duck?
Nope.
Nope.
Yeah, this is a Christmas tree.
Even Clarence Nash.
All this candy free.
Not him.
Oh, yes, all this candy's free.
Not
candy
Danny Kaye, is it?
Christmas tree. What the happy
Mickey Katz?
Nope.
What
good guess.
Merry Christmas tree.
It's called Ja, das ist ein Christmas tree.
Mel Brooks.
You're close. It's Mel Blanc.
I was just gonna, once you said
yes.
that one.
Yes, I could not find any research on this. I don't know why this exists. So I'm going to throw this out to our listeners. If you know anything about this Mel Blanc Christmas song, contact us on social media. Now, this last one is sung by somebody who was here recently, Gil. There's your hint. Somebody who was in this room and on this show. And I'll be surprised if you know this one.
I'm gonna put some glue.
Not Diane Ladd.
No. No.
Dick Van Dyke?
No. Recently.
Danny Aiello. Pat Cooper.
I'll spread it on the floor, the window.
I'm glazing over.
Is this, do you know anything?
Oh, wait,
does this ring a bell?
Is this the Impressionist?
Nope, it's Joel Grey.
Holy
this isn't from the
Rankin
Bass special.
No,
the night
it's
Christmas,
about it's
it
a
not.
Novelty song about a budding serial killer who devises an elaborate scheme to trap Santa Claus.
Okay.
Mickey Katz's son.
From 1955. Yes, you guessed Mickey Katz before.
So that was the origin of Nightmare Before Christmas, basically.
Yeah. What do you think of that Rankin Bass one with Joel Grey?
It's cute. It's all right. You know, it's not stop action. It's all, I don't, they're 2D stuff I don't love as much.
Yeah.
Like Frosty pisses me off.
Yeah. And you were friends with Jules Bass.
I was friends with him.
We were talking about him before we put the mics on.
I met him at my gym, and he's this fit, like, amazing man. He's adorable. He's just, I flipped out. I was like, I gave him my copy of my special, Laugh Whore, and he loved it and called me up, and he's just a sweet guy. And I've spent some Christmas parties with him. And I remember saying to him, you know, on the DVD extras, you're not on there. Why? They're interviewing Arthur Rankin Jr. and you're not being interviewed.
That's weird.
He's like, I'm not doing that crap anymore. I said, Jules, you look so much better now. You had that Jufro before. You look terrible. I said, they show pictures of you. I said, now you're like, you look so great. You need to speak on these DVD extras so people don't think you're dead. He didn't listen to me. But I haven't spoken to him in a long
time. He's a bit of a recluse, isn't he? He doesn't give interviews.
Yeah, he doesn't. Yeah, he doesn't. He doesn't.
Yeah.
He's the Walt Disney of Christmas.
Yeah. And he's, yeah. Speaking of Rankin Bass, We talked about this last time, but I found this, and I thought you would find this interesting. Last time we talked, we did a ranking of Rankin-Bass cartoons.
Oh, okay.
And you were not happy with
we did a ranking of Christmas movies that pissed me off.
We did a Rankin-Bass one, and then we ranked the Christmas Carol
versions.
Yeah, that's right. And that pissed you off.
Yeah.
I want to get your take on this, and I'm only going to read five.
All right.
I'm only going to read the top five. And I know Gilbert, you know some of these too.
Yeah.
This is in Sci-Fi Wire magazine. And this is they ranked the Rankin-Bass specials. Let me get to it. And no, I'll do the top 10 because we'll go fast.
Okay.
Number 10, they picked Jack Frost.
It's not bad.
With Buddy Hackett and Larry Storch.
Do you, Buddy Hackett? Here's...
Oh, yeah. Oh, well, my
Look,
favorite
it's Jack
line.
Frost.
I hate Jack Frost. Oh, boy. I can't believe I'm meeting Jack Frost.
That's very
we
funny.
Had Buddy Hackett's son on the show a couple of weeks ago, and he did not approve of Gilbert's Buddy Hackett impression.
Well, you don't do it in front of them. You do it behind their back. What's wrong with you?
And of course, since we brought up Buddy Hackett, what I have to do in every other podcast is the famous death scene from Bud and Lou.
Oh, God.
And so Lou Costello, Buddy Hackett as Lou Costello's dying, Artie Johnson comes in as his agent and sneaks him under his jacket a strawberry malted. And Buddy Hackett takes a sip and very weakly goes, "You know, I think I've had a lot of strawberry maltage in my day, but this one's the best." And then he closes his eyes and falls back dead.
Not how Lou Costello died.
Wonderful.
Yeah. You seen it? It's terrible.
No, I can't.
It's terrible. Okay, number 9, they picked Rudolph's Shiny New Year.
It's all right. It's basically Dumbo.
Technically not a Christmas
special. The Baby New Year has the big ears. It's all the same shit.
Yeah. Frank Gorshin's in that one. Yeah. Red Skelton.
Yep. Yeah.
You know who's still alive, by the way, speaking of Maury Laws, who was the animator.
He is, right?
He's alive at 95.
He wrote the music. Jules wrote the lyrics.
How about
that? And not for Rudolph, but that was mostly Johnny Marks. But for the rest of them, it was he's still alive.
95.
And when Romeo Mueller died a while
I think
ago.
Romeo Mueller died.
Yeah.
Here's number 8 that they ranked. The Stingiest Man in Town.
No,
that's the Christmas Carol version.
No,
you don't care
great.
For it.
No, it's not that great. It's okay. It's good.
With Matthau?
Yeah, with Walter Matthau.
Oh,
that's the best thing about it.
And Theodore Bekel, Gilbert, your favorite.
Oh my God.
Can't get chewier than that.
No. Nah.
I gotta watch that one.
They
now.
Say the most memorable thing about that one is the ghosts that haunt Scrooge are capable of being seriously creepy, even in the exaggerated Rankin-Bass style.
Well, it's 2D.
Humbug.
How about number 7? The First Christmas, the story of the first Christmas snow.
That's
from
good.
1975.
With Angela Lansbury?
Angela Lansbury,
I like that
and
one.
Cyril Richard.
It's good. It's actually very good.
Yeah.
With the nun, there's a nun in it. But she didn't.
And a blind shepherd boy.
Yes. And but this nun did not embezzle $500,000 and gamble it in Vegas. Did you hear about them?
No.
Oh, the two nuns.
No.
Wow,
I love
hear
it. About
and one it. Of them looked like a cousin of mine. I'm like, oh my God, it's my cousin Jeannie.
Number 6, they picked The Life and Adventures of Santa Claus. I don't know this one.
I know that one. It's good. It's like another version of Santa Claus is Coming to Town, but it's a little more kind of, the tone of it's a little more serious. And
largely unknown
a little
cast.
More mystical.
Alfred Drake.
This list.
Alfred Drake,
Do you have Santa Claus versus the Martians?
No, that's not
this is Rankin-Bass.
That's a good movie.
We're doing Rankin-Bass.
Stay on the path. The worst.
But you can talk about that if you like when I get through with
know,
these.
Yes. Why don't you go home and we'll finish this? Go ahead. God. Go ahead.
Okay, quickly. Number 5, Santa Claus is Coming to Town.
It's great.
Yeah.
It's great.
With Mickey, with Keenan Wynn as the Winter Warlock.
Yeah, he's magnificent.
He was good.
Love
that one.
And all those kids, my husband hates that because he can't stand all the kids. My husband, Jerry, when all the kids are like, when Fred Astaire is telling the story and the kids are all like all together, they're like, oh, that's how Santa came down the chimney. Okay. Oh, that's
every story.
How his reindeer learned how to fly. Yeah, the children.
Great performance by Paul Frees, by the way, in that one, as the Burgermeister.
Burgermeister, Meisterburger.
Yeah.
I love his sidekick who's really gay. He's like, Burgermeister, Meisterburger. We found toys on the sidewalk.
He's like a Franklin Pangborn in Rankin Bass.
He is.
Number four, I know how you feel about Frosty. Number four, Frosty the Snowman. Yeah.
Well, first of all, he takes that little girl into the greenhouse at the end and gets all hot and melts. He's a pedophile. That's all there is to it. Happy birthday. Get the right holiday, all right, you piece of shit?
Found out Jackie Vernon's
like
Italian.
Yeah.
What's his real name?
Verone.
Verone.
Verone. Yeah. How about that?
That was another controversy with the songs about everybody getting crazy about the holiday songs. Frosty the Snowman. Smoking a pipe around the kids the whole time.
Oh, smoking pipe around the kids.
Smoking a pipe. The kids could deal with it, so they get a little secondhand smoke. Yeah. Big fucking deal.
Jackie Vernon.
It's not as bad as him being accused of being a pedophile,
that's,
I guess.
Jackie
He's
Vernon.
He's also not wearing any pants.
For years.
The voice of God.
Oh, that's what it is. Yeah. Yeah, but he doesn't have a dick, so it doesn't matter.
For years, Jackie Vernon did that thing with the clicker.
Yes, sure.
Here are some slides from my vacation.
Who else
Here
does
we
Jackie
are
Vernon?
Being that's led very around funny. The quicksand. And here's a bunch of hats and ropes and things.
And then the sequel to that was Frosty's Winter Wonderland.
Yes, not on the list.
His wife is Shelley Winters, you know.
Right.
Oh.
And she's like, oh, Santa. Santa, look at me. I don't want to melt. I'm so hot. I need to get into a freezer.
See, now I imagine fags love Shelley Winters.
We love Shelley Winters. Yeah.
What is the connection there?
Because she's one of those women.
It's a camp thing,
wild,
in a way.
Fat, annoying.
Boy, you ever watch her in A Place in the Sun with Montgomery Clifton? Right. Liz Taylor is so beautiful. And then Shelley Winters, when she's like begging him, talk about baby, it's cold outside. She's like, you don't like me. And I love you, George. I'm pregnant, George. You don't like me. You look like a girl better than me. I mean, it's just
first
so
time
pathetic.
I ever saw you do stand up.
What was that movie with Shelley Winters and John Garfield?
Oh, you got me stumped.
I don't know. I love John Garfield, too. I don't know.
We'll have to ask the booth.
It wasn't The Postman Always Rings Twice.
If Dara's out there, maybe Dara can find that. First time I ever saw you do stand up.
Yes.
At Caroline's in the early 90s. Mm-hmm. You did the Poseidon Adventure
bit. Yeah, I did.
When she was
climbing up the tree and all that shit. Yeah.
Really funny.
Mrs. Peter Pan, I'm not.
She always and you did it in Laugh War, too.
I did. Yeah. I did do it in Laugh War.
Number three, 'Twas the Night Before Christmas.
Mm. No.
Yeah.
No.
You don't like that one.
It's
That's all with Joel
right.
Gray and
it's fine.
George Gobel.
Nah. Yeah, next.
And Gilbert John MacGyver.
Oh my
look,
God.
Sis, everything must be right according to schedule. We will have no slackers in this organization.
That's hilarious.
Everything must be done as soon as possible.
Who else, Mario, does Jackie Vernon and can slip into John MacGyver?
Only him.
Only him.
But
and this is Jackie Vernon and John MacGyver in A Mice and Men.
Oh, God.
Tell me about the rabbits, George. Well, I'm going to have a farm with rabbits on it. And I get to tend to the rabbits, don't I, George? Yes, and if we have friends, we say stay.
This happens every week. Gilbert, put that in the act.
That's hilarious.
Number two. In their ranking, what the hell do they know? Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
Okay, yeah.
1964.
And what's number one? I'm dying now.
They say that Yukon Cornelius is the best Rankin-Bass character ever created.
He's a bear. He's a big
he's
gay
a
bear.
Bear.
He's a bear. He's got a little chihuahua and a poodle. He's a big gay bear. He's like a guy in Chelsea. Just a big muscular guy walking little dogs. I mean, that's what he is.
And the one they love the best.
Better be the Little Drummer Boy.
It's the Year Without a Santa Claus.
Oh.
First of all, let me tell you something about that special. The Heat Miser and the Snow Miser, they're fantastic.
Yeah.
But it's really not a great special. It's kind of boring. You mean to tell me the Little Drummer Boy is not on those?
I'll find the ranking. Yeah,
it's
I just
the
did this
because
I knew it was going to piss
off. It's Romeo Muller's favorite one too. You know, Little Drummer Boy. I mean, he's this little Jewish kid, and the oh my God, don't make me cry.
nice.
They do the flashback at the beginning where the mother and father are murdered by the desert bandits.
Ooh.
The desert bandits come in And they cut, you know, because it's the whole, it's the Middle Eastern conflict in a Rankin Bass special. They kill the mother and father. They stab the mother with they throw a knife at the father. It goes right in him because he's a puppet. He's wood, so it stuck really well. And then they burn the house and the mother, and they went up in flames because they're puppets. They're made of wood. So, and then he goes off, and he's so pissed off and angry, and he's got this magical drum that his mother and father gave him, and he's got this lamb and this camel and this sheep. Lamb, it was a lamb, a camel, and what's the other one? Oh, my God, I can't believe I can't remember it. It's not a frog. But anyway,
I don't think so.
But, a ferret.
But he's yelling at them to dance. He's like, dance faster, Sasha, dance fast. And he's really angry at the little lamb. He's like, dad, you could do better. He's brutal. He's so angry. Even when he sees Jesus, he does not smile. He's like, fuck this shit. My lamb's dead. Make it alive. And then Jesus makes the
lamb. It's 50 years old this year, the Little Drummer Boy.
It's 1968.
Okay, so now you're going to get very pissed off because they rank that as 19th out of 19.
You know what? Ooh. They can suck my drummer boy dick. And Greer Garson was the narrator. And the little drummer boy hated people, all people. He was a miserable little bastard. He really was. But he saw a great shining star. And he was wrong, as anyone was ever wrong.
Okay.
A song called One Star.
Yeah.
And that's special. That's
so that's
gorgeous.
You think that should be number one, and they put it at 19.
Well, what's this magazine?
It's called Sci-Fi Wire.
What does a sci-fi magazine know about fucking Rankin Bass specials? It's not sci-fi. It's stop action animation.
I'll give you their names.
I'll call them.
Let's try something.
All right, what are we doing?
Okay, here we go.
Oh, God, here we go. Scripts.
You know what this is.
I love a script. Oh, God. Okay.
Okay, so we're going to... So the parts are marked.
Okay.
What do you think, Gil?
Let's do it. Okay. Oh, God. Please try to stay in tempo.
Oh,
there's not a chance.
This will be impossible.
Silent night. All is calm. All is bright. Round and faces. Mother and child, holy infant, so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace.
Silent night, holy night, shepherds quake at the sight. Glory stream from heaven afar. Heavenly hosts sing hallelujah. Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born.
Silent night, holy night. Son of God, all of pure light.
Radiant beams from thy holy face, with the dawn of redeeming grace. Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. Jesus, Lord, at thy birth.
Was quite good, Groucho. I really enjoyed singing with you. You're wonderful. You could do that in your sleep. In fact, I think you did do that in your sleep.
I've always loved Christmas.
I mean, yes, it's lovely.
Because,
what's the magic word today?
So I think it's Parkinson's.
Is it really? I don't have Parkinson's. That's a rumor, and that's not true, and I find that very offensive.
Because,
Groucho.
I don't know if I'm having a stroke or if you're shaking more than usual.
Well, I'm shaking because it's just something that's hereditary. It's in my family. My mother before her, my mother's 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 mother before her, and my father's father before him had shaking disease.
Is there an earthquake happening right
now? That's having a heart attack.
That was fun. That was a good one, Frank.
That was beautiful.
I enjoyed that one. Come on.
I worked to please you.
And Gilbert actually kind of stayed in time.
Well, I picked a slow one.
Oh, that was right on. It was right on.
He knows the tune.
I'll tell you.
Gilbert, you do know Silent Night, don't you?
Yes.
His musical skills are just unparalleled.
What was the bit you used to do about Michael Jackson and Katharine Hepburn? Where he would do all the work on himself and she would become...
His nose. Michael, look at yourself. What did you do? Because they were friends at one time. Michael, what did you do to your nose? What did you do? Your nose looks like a vagina.
Now, I heard that Katharine Hepburn...
I couldn't even remember that. Oh, my God.
Which really is not a surprise once you think about it. It was a major dyke.
Absolutely. And so supposedly Spencer Tracy was either bisexual or gay. I mean, they supposedly really didn't have sex. If you read Scotty Bauer's book, Full Service, Katie would say to Scotty, I need some pussy tonight. Now get me someone. Call him right up.
God. Now you
it's
heard that
show.
Story.
What?
It's probably not true, but it should be.
What?
The one where Michael Jackson, Marlon Brando, and Elizabeth Taylor tried to escape the country.
Do you want to know? I saw them the night before that supposedly happened. It was September 10th, 2001. I was in the audience, and Brando wasn't on stage that night, but he was in New York. He just didn't do the second night. But they supposedly got in a car together and had to, because they were there for 9/11, so they had to like get in a car. I don't know if that's true or not. And then they did a series about it in England, and Joseph Fiennes, Ralph Fiennes' brother, played Michael Jackson, and there was a big thing about it.
Ooh.
People were not happy about it, and I think Stalker Channing played Elizabeth Taylor.
Right.
I want to see it so bad because I love Stalker Channing.
Who is Brando?
I don't know. It wasn't me. It should have been. But I don't know who it was. The three of them in a car is like, Liz, you're too fat. I can't fit. There's not enough room for the three of us. Michael, please. Could you put the chimp in the trunk? Because I can't. He smells.
Did you hear?
What?
That Marlon Brando fucked Richard Pryor in the ass.
Yep. Yeah. Who said that? Quincy Jones. Quincy Jones said it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know who fucked who in the ass, but I know they had sex.
Well, I like to think of it as Marlon Brando because 800 pounds on top.
Yeah. He's the top. So you think Pryor was the bottom, is what you're saying. And Brando was the top.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Well. God, he got so fat. What happened?
You used to do that bit, too, about him in the witness stand with the Christian Brando trial.
Oh, my God. He was like Humpty Brando on the stand. Remember when his son had the murder?
Yeah.
My son's a good kid. He really is. He didn't mean to do it. It's my fault. I was a bad father. Is the court stenographer going to eat that blueberry muffin? Because I'm starving. It was a son, Michael, and I had it killed because this Sicilian thing has got to stop.
You want to answer a couple of questions from listeners?
Sure.
Who want to know
I
things?
I like Godfather 2 better than Godfather.
It's really better.
It's brilliant. They're both great, but yes, it is.
Yeah.
Well, De Niro is stunning.
Yeah.
Stunning. All right, what are the questions?
From Robert Martin. Hey, Mario. If you could bring one Rankin Bass special to the stage, which one would you pick and which part would you choose for yourself?
Well, I'm too old for all of them at this point in my career. But I would bring the Little Drummer Boy.
You would?
Well, they would never have. They don't play it anymore because they think it's racist because it portrays Arabs as terrorists, so that's a whole thing too. So they don't play it anymore, and they're the Desert Bandits.
Right,
know. They don't say it, but you know
what it is. What part would you like to play?
I would play
Brando.
I guess I'd have to play the Jose Ferrer part, Ben Harriman.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I didn't know Jose Ferrer married Rosemary Clooney twice.
Why?
They did you know that?
No, twice.
Like, yeah,
they broke up and they married again.
Yeah, I found that out while researching her while I was watching White Christmas.
What is wrong with people? All right, go ahead.
Jason Grissom, what in Mario's opinion is the single worst Christmas song ever recorded?
Well, the Razzleberry Christmas. The Razzleberry. I hate that song.
Well, could I have a Christmas tree with Razzleberry dressing?
a little whittleberry would be nice.
You're picking up the slack for Richard?
And I'm going to tell you something right now. Julie Stein must have been drunk when he wrote that score.
First of all, fuck you. I love the Mr. Magoo Christmas Carol.
Don't let me get over there. I'm coming across the table.
It's good to be back on Broadway. Oh,
that song's awful. I'm bad,
now
bad.
We have a Christmas tree.
Go, Gil.
You're torturing
me. Thank you, Frank.
Me.
Some waffle jelly cake, perhaps a slice. And wood on the fire.
I hate that little kid, that balding little fuck. Ugh, wipe your mouth. Oh, shut up.
Play I'm All Alone in the World.
Oh, please.
That
one's a shame.
So you're torturing
worst.
Him. You're torturing him.
He is left here. Nobody wants him. Poor lad. Poor lonely child. Poor lonely child.
Is that supposed to be singing?
When you're alone, alone in the world. When you're alone.
This song's not too bad. Not a bad song.
Somebody give Mario a tissue.
All right.
Okay. So
shut this
so
up.
Razzleberry dressing is
yeah,
your answer.
Yeah, and I hate
answer.
The opening number. I'm back on Broadway. That's the worst. Oh,
did you
I'm gonna
see?
Watch it again just so I can see it again and go, am I wrong or am I right? And next year I'll let you know.
Okay.
What?
Okay, Gil.
Did I see what?
Did you see the Leslie Nielsen live action Mr. Magoo?
Oh my God!
Bad.
Oh my God!
Bad, like really bad.
I didn't even know that existed.
Yeah. Sure.
And it's you know how they'll take a review and they'll chop it up
sure,
a
they'll.
Bad review,
yep.
You know, like they'll say, like if the review said Al Pacino was great in The Godfather, but in this he's awful. They'll go Al Pacino was great.
Yeah. Yeah.
So in here, the only review they're able to chop up. It's in one word, they go, slapstick, New York Times.
That's it?
Yes. Yes.
That's fucking hilarious.
That? How desperate.
I don't even remember that. Was that
hilarious.
In the 90s?
That's
oh my God.
Wow.
It was
poor Leslie Nielsen.
Awful. Mm.
Okay, this one's for you, Gil, from Beth Howley. Gilbert, was there ever a toy you wanted badly and asked for Hanukkah? And also, did you miss not having a Christmas?
Let's see. There were I knew as a kid this idea of like big expensive toys we weren't going to get. It's just like I knew there were name products that were never in the house.
But your parents got you the Aurora models and some of the monster
Aurora.
Stuff.
I love the Aurora models, the Aurora monster models.
Did your dad sell those in the hardware store?
Yeah, he would sell them sometimes. Most of the time, they'd buy them from another
place.
They
were monster models?
Yeah, Aurora models.
Oh, you don't know that.
I was too busy collecting Disney ceramics.
Yeah. Oh, the Aurora monster models. They had Frankenstein, Dracula, Wolfman.
King Kong.
And one time, my mother, I guess it was like, 2-for-1 kind of thing. They were taped together. There was The Bride of Frankenstein and another one called The Witch. And they were like together. Yeah.
What witch was it? That's vague. What witch was it? Was it Margaret
it
Hamilton?
It was just
a witch.
Just a witch.
The witch. The generic witch.
Oh, all right.
Yeah. Generic witch.
Did you have a toy that you wanted desperately as a child for Christmas?
First of all, I had one of those little organs that had the chord buttons on the side, and I never learned to play the organ. I don't know why I got it and why. I was a spoiled brat. You know one of those like bad organs?
Like
you press the chord buttons on the side. I had one of those. I just like Disney things. I like Disney ceramics. I like Disney
books. You still
books.
Collect that stuff, don't you?
No, don't embarrass me.
Okay.
shut up. Don't reveal my secrets, Frank. But I like
I've seen them in your house.
I love like Christopher Finch's Big, The Art of Walt Disney book. It's a great book. I mean, I love that. I loved Leonard Maltin's The Disney Films. That's a great book.
It's wonderful.
Like I like stuff like that. Like toys? No. Like
you weren't a toy kid.
Yeah, I guess not.
Yeah, I guess I was not.
I mean,
I like the models.
Oh, I like the Fisher Price Castle.
Yeah.
And the Fisher Price, they don't make them anymore. And the Fisher Price Village. I used to like make animated stop action movies with my. I had a Technicolor 8mm camera. And I had all these films.
Oh,
and
that's cool.
And I did the Poseidon Adventure in my backyard. Ooh. And I made the kid jump off the upside down table from the top of my porch. I could have been arrested. And they had to catch her. Like, remember Pamela Sue Martin?
Sure.
Jumped and they caught her in the tablecloth.
Yeah.
The kids caught the girl. I mean, I can't believe it. See, and then I had a little boat in my pool, and I would throw a big bucket of water over it so it tipped over. I had to do like several
takes. You glued the furniture to the ceiling and...
Oh, yeah. Oh, it was okay. It was in the backyard. Okay, like, it was under open sky. It was a bad set.
This is proof of a total faggot that as a kid, you're enacting the Poseidon.
That's right, I am. There you go. You said there was your point. I proved your point. Shelley Winters, right there. I had Leanne play Shelley Winters. She was magnificent. See? He's right.
Hilarious. Yeah. I know Gilbert. I know Gilbert's been
I know someone's going to probably tweet me the witch.
Oh, you're
I'm sure they are.
I'm sure they are. The picture of the witch, I want to see it. Yeah.
This is from Sean Liu. Gilbert, I know you've been in a few Christmas-related projects. You're in that, what, Buddy the Elf's Christmas?
Buddy
with
the
Ed,
Elf.
Ed Asner.
And, oh, and that one, Mandy, something and Mandy... Evil Christmas.
Oh, yeah, I know
Billy
what that is.
And Mandy. Billy and Mandy's Christmas. Save Christmas.
Very good, Seth.
You've done a lot of things.
Evil Santa.
Under the wire and
a lot
unknown.
Of crap.
wait, I like the Elf special, Buddy the Elf. That's a good, it's based on this Broadway show, right?
Yes.
Matthew Sklar wrote that, who wrote The Prom, which is on Broadway right now, and it's fantastic.
So Sean wants to know, Mario, if you've been in any TV-related TV shows or films.
I was
Christmas-related.
Oh, yes, I was. I was in one that was on Lifetime last year that they're repeating a lot. It's called A Very Merry Toy Store.
Oh.
And I'll stop there.
Who's in it?
Melissa Joan Hart.
Oh, good.
Mario Lopez, who I adore. And Melissa, she's terrific. Her mother directed it, Paula. Billy Gardell, who was terrific in it. It was a fun shoot. We had a really good time.
I
played the mayor of New Britain, Connecticut.
I was in Saved by the Bell Wedding in Vegas.
Well, that's the greatest thing I've ever heard.
Very good. What does that have to do with Christmas?
Because Mario Lopez. I love Mario.
You've both worked with Mario Lopez. Leslie Alves wants to know, Mario, what does Liza think of your impersonation of her?
Oh, well.
And has she ever commented on your Judy Garland?
Yeah, she doesn't like that I do Judy Garland because she... just doesn't. She doesn't like when anybody reveres or makes fun of her mother. And I don't make fun of her mother. That's what she said.
It's a tribute.
She said she doesn't like that I make fun of her mother. I said, the last thing I do is make fun of your mother. I put her on a pedestal. I love her. I think she's great. Liza, I think she's okay with me doing her.
Right.
But, you know, she
has a sense of humor.
She does have a sense of humor.
I was on an airplane with her. Liza Minnelli.
How was that?
She was sitting. Flight. Oh, she was sitting with some black woman who I guess was her helper or something. And when then the plane landed, a bag fell and hit the black woman on the head, to which Liza Minnelli was laughing uncontrollably.
It fell on your head. Look at that. You have a bruise now. It's so funny. Life is a cabaret. Come to the cabaret.
I think we need a musical accompaniment on every episode.
Well, we
brings a lot.
I've been asking for this for years. Took
I've
them
never
four
seen
fucking
that
years.
Scene My pleasure. Out.
Great.
Right. Was that good?
You I tell a story you. And it comes to life.
And they were playing cabaret.
I bet they were. If you landed in New York, they were probably playing New York, New York. And they were probably playing Frank Sinatra's version, which infuriates her.
Oh, she doesn't like Frank Sinatra's version.
Well, it's my song. Right. Well, guess what?
Her song.
Is it the Mets or the Yankees? I forget. One of the two. One of the New York.
Yankees,
when they,
Yankees.
It's the Yankees. When the Yankees lose, when they win,
They
play Frank Sinatra's New York, New York. When they lose, they play mine. I find that really offensive. I really do. I think it's so
offensive.
Hey,
can you do Judy Garland toward the very end singing The Man Who Got Away?
Wait, I'm going to not do that because I'm going to sing her at the very end.
Yes.
Doing the last song she ever did on Johnny Carson.
Oh, well, Bill to it, Gil.
Oh, okay.
Bill, doesn't he know the program? He gives everything away.
Not a chance.
God,
he didn't even know Richard Kind was on the phone.
His middle name is Spoiler Alert.
Last one. Gilbert, this is for you. Karen Rossio. Gilbert, why isn't there a Hanukkah song other than Adam Sandler's Hanukkah song? Or a good Hanukkah movie, and would you star in one if the price was right?
Yeah, if the price was
right.
He'd start a snuff film.
Yeah.
Oh my God. He'd do a snuff film for $2.50 a week, and I'm talking $2.50.
If they had free lunch, that would be enough for me to do a movie.
And they could put him up at a Motel 6. It would just be fine.
Okay, we'll do a little more music.
Oh, boy.
This one you're going to have to work a little harder.
Give it.
Okay, Gil.
Oh, geez.
Gil, yours are in red. Mario's are in black.
You know why? Because my husband is black.
That's not.
No, not true. I love my husband. I miss him. He's in Seattle a lot now.
Try to keep up, Gil.
Yeah, Gil.
Okay, yes.
Frosty the Snowman was a jolly, happy soul with a corncob pipe and a button nose and his eyes made out of coal.
Frosty the Snowman made the children laugh and play. When they surprised before their eyes, he came to life that day.
There must have been some magic in that old silk hat they found. And when they placed it on his head, he began to dance around.
Frosty the Snowman was alive as he could be, and the children say he could laugh and play, and just the same as you and me.
Frosty the Snowman knew the sun was hot that day, so he said, let's run and have some fun now before I melt away.
So down to the village with a broomstick in his hand, running here and there all around the square, staying, catch me if you can.
Ow, 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 he led them down the streets of town, right to the traffic cop, ow, ow, ow. And he only paused a moment when he heard them holler, oh, stop.
Frosty the Snowman had to hurry on his way, but he waved goodbye, saying, don't you cry, I'll be back again someday.
Thumpity thump thump, thumpity thump thump, look at Frosty go. Oh yes, thumpity thump thump, thumpity thump thump, over the hills of snow. Oh yes, Frosty the Snowman. He really is a marvelous, marvelous creature. Yes! Oh, yes.
Oh.
Well, Gilbert Gottfried. I've had a stroke, and I still think you're an asshole.
Just to recap, that was Julia Child, Jerry Seinfeld, Cher. Nice work, Mayor.
Well.
Peter Lorre. Carol Channing, Andrew Dice Clay, Charles Nelson Reilly, Hervé Villechaize, and of course, post-stroke Betty.
Oh, yes. Well, Christmas would not be Christmas without me, Betty Davis. Oh, yes. Merry Christmas to my little elves, Gilbert Gottfried. Yes. I wish I was married to Gilbert Gottfried, because then I could stay at a Motel 6, too, and really go to town at the vending machine.
You don't like the way he treats himself.
I do not like it at all. I think he should stay at a Four Seasons or something, even a Hilton. Try a Hilton. It's really okay. A Sheraton.
Well, do one more quick thing before your big number.
Oh, God.
Before your big closing number. Okay.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. This
I need more. Can I get some water or some tea?
I got one for you.
Oh, good.
Hang on, buddy.
I feel like Barbara Streisand. I need my tea before I sing. I have two Christmas albums. One is, thank you very much. I love duets. I love
now,
to
Now, what
sing
is the people. Thing about Barbara Streisand and fags? What's the attraction there?
I really find that offensive, Gilbert. Just because I drink tea a lot while I sing doesn't mean that a lot of homosexuals like me. And they do have the best taste, so I do like, you know, James and I,
live in a barn, but the barn has been renovated, and it's all laid out in my new book, My Passion for Design, where I talk about my secretary, Renata, who makes kale chips. She crisps kale in the oven and drizzles olive oil and lemon all over them. They're delicious. They're almost as good as potato chips. I love chocolate. I love to eat chocolate.
Are you still baking, by the way? You're still doing the baking and dropping it off at the local...
I just dropped it off yesterday, but this is going to air on the 24th, so it'll be gone by then.
Okay. Do you want a quick quiz, or do you want to go to the song?
No, let's go.
Okay. Mm. This is something I made up. This is called Santa or Satan. Because if you unscramble Santa, you get Satan. Did these actors play Santa Claus or the devil?
Okay. This is great.
What do you think, Gil?
Okay.
Okay. They start off very easy.
Yeah.
Robert De Niro.
He played the devil.
The devil, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, and Angel Heart.
We should have buzzers.
Good. Yes. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. De Niro.
Al Pacino.
Devil. The devil.
Very good.
And devil's advocate.
Look at him go.
Yeah.
See? Look at him.
Very
He's excited.
Keanu Reeves.
I love Keanu Reeves. Yeah.
Okay.
I do.
This one's a layup for you, Gilbert. Did Lon Chaney Jr. play the devil or Santa Claus?
Yes. He played the devil. I think it was... It was that Swedish production. What the fuck was the name of
it? It was called The Devil's Messenger.
Devil's Messenger.
In 1961.
Devil's Messenger... And he was like put in between little stories. They had like a bunch of little scary stories, and he was the devil.
He knows too much.
And he was, you know, the good, fat alcoholic Lon Chaney Jr. And I remember at one point in that movie, a guy says to him, you know, that's very evil what you said, but then what could it be? When it's in an evil place like this. And Chaney goes, that's funny. It's a pun. I don't like puns, but that's a pun. And I thought, no, that's not a pun. I was like 3 years old. I was going, it's the same word. It's not a pun. But, you know, Lon Chaney Jr., you're not going to ask him to shoot it twice.
No, of course not. You're lucky to get one sober
take.
They
used to show that a lot on TV.
Devil's Messenger. Very good.
Yeah.
Okay, they get a little harder. Lloyd Bridges.
Ooh.
Did Lloyd Bridges play the devil?
Santa Claus.
He did. Very good. Do you remember him playing Santa Claus?
No, I don't.
Okay.
Was this a TV special?
It was a TV movie called In the Nick of Time.
Yeah.
From 1991.
Yeah.
Okay. Hume Cronin.
He played Santa Claus.
Very good.
Yeah.
In what? In Santa and Pete.
Is that what it was called?
Yes, a TV movie from 1999. I didn't give you features, too many features, because that's too easy.
I don't know as much as Gilbert when it comes to details of what these random fucking movies are.
So far, you haven't gotten one wrong.
Yeah, but I know. Go ahead.
Okay. Gilbert, John Ritter. John Ritter.
I'm going to say the devil.
I'm going to say Santa.
Gilbert's got it.
He played fuck him!
Would you fuck me?
No! Stop trying. I'm going to Me Too you. Pound me too. Well, you know what I mean.
Not literally pound.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was in Holy Moses, the Dudley Moore Lorraine Newman extravaganza. You remembered that John Ritter played?
I remember he was the devil. Yeah.
Very good. Very good. I thought that was going to be a hard one.
I worked with Lorraine Newman in Problem Child 2.
Yes, you did.
I love Lorraine Newman.
She's the best.
She's a great girl.
She's the
so
best.
So talented and
okay.
sweet.
Okay.
She's a Jew, you know.
I know.
Yeah.
Just like you. But I like her and hate you, so I'm conflicted. I'm a conflicted anti-Semite.
I'm staying out of this. Saltzman's hanging
stay out of it.
I love Mr. Saltzman.
He's the best. Art Carney.
Santa Claus.
Yeah, absolutely.
He was an alcoholic Santa Claus. Was it on the Twilight Zone?
Well, he wasn't actual Santa.
Yeah.
But
he was a department store Santa Claus.
Right.
And he was an alcoholic. And he was fired from the job.
He knows too much.
And he's sitting out on the street, and there's a little kid with him.
I'll take that, although I was going for people who played actual Santa, not someone who played Santa Claus.
All right.
In the Great Santa Claus Switch, and he's in The Night They Saved Christmas with Paul Williams.
Oh.
Wow.
Our friend Paul Williams, a TV movie. Okay, here's a couple of podcast guests.
Paul Williams. Yes.
No, that wasn't a question. Chuck McCann.
He played Santa.
So many
very good.
He was a kid show.
About rainbows and what's on the other side.
It's the worst Kermit the Frog I've ever heard.
Rainbows are visions, but only illusions. Rainbows have nothing to hide.
What is that?
What's so
amazing?
Oh, that's who it is. Yeah.
Keep
sorry.
Them gazing, and what do they hope they might see?
There's no stopping him.
One day we'll find it, the rainbow connection, the lovers, the dreamers, and me.
Beautiful.
Well, if I was the great acting coach Stella Adler, I would say that's unclear. Okay.
Okay. Chuck McCann, you said, played Santa. He did in a very retail Christmas.
Oh, God.
What about our friend Ed Asner, Gil?
Oh,
Santa.
Yes, Santa.
In Elf. And three other projects. And another podcast
and
guest.
And he's a Jew. Jew yes, Santa.
Indeed. Yeah. Peter Fonda.
Peter Fonda, devil.
You're right, yeah, and the Ghost Rider.
Yeah, well, he did a lot of drugs. He had to play the
very devil. Good. I don't think you guys got one wrong.
I did. Go ahead.
You got one wrong.
Yeah.
Here are two actors. What do these two actors have in common? Sebastian Cabot and Mickey Rooney.
They both played Santa Claus. Sebastian Cabot played Santa Claus in the TV remake of Miracle on 34th Street.
Correct.
I remember that one.
Correct.
And Mickey Rooney played Santa Claus in The Year Without a Santa Claus.
The Marlo Thomas?
And in Santa Claus is Coming to Town.
You are correct, sir. But there's
I finally
more.
I had some detail. Oh, God, what is it?
I singled them out because they both also played the devil.
Oh, well, that makes sense.
Sebastian Cabot played Pip in a Twilight Zone episode.
Oh, that's right.
A Nice Place to Visit.
That's right. Was that the one with Carradine or? No. That's the one that takes place in Las Vegas.
Correct.
And it's a gambler.
Correct.
Yes.
And he played Santa in the Miracle on 34th Street remake on television.
And Mickey Rooney played Pip in.
And Rooney.
That's right.
One time I saw Mickey Rooney on a talk show when he was really old and alcoholic and angry. And somebody said that somebody said Cary Grant was gay. And Mickey Rooney gets angry, kicks his foot up in the air and goes, "Oh, please, Cary Grant was as gay as my foot." I don't know what that meant.
He had,
beautiful.
He had tiny feet.
Yes, they both Mickey Rooney and Sebastian Cabot played Santa Claus and the devil. Rooney played Santa three times in Santa Claus is Coming to Town, The Year Without a Santa Claus, and something else I didn't write down. And he played the devil in The Private Lives of Adam and Eve with Mamie Van Doren.
Oh, my God.
She's a Facebook friend of mine.
She's alive, Mamie Van Doren?
Oh, my God, yeah.
She is.
We got to get her on here.
She's in L.A. You got to fly her in, you cheap
Now
fox.
We'll do a... And Mel Torme and Paul Anka are also in that one.
Oh, God. Oh, wow.
Okay, now group these people.
Can you do a Mel Torme?
No, I cannot. Oh. Don't waste my time. Go ahead.
Here's a group of actors. Did this group play Santa or did they play the devil?
Oh, my God.
And the group is Austin Pendleton, Robert Wagner, and Bryan Cranston.
The devil.
It seems like it would be the devil.
They were all Santas.
Oh, geez.
We both got that wrong.
Yeah.
And I'm very happy about that.
And the other one, obviously, by default, Cheech Marin, George Burns, and Robert Goulet all played Satan.
Well, that's great.
You guys did very, very well.
I can't believe that Lon Chaney Jr. movie popped up.
Well, there you go,
Gil.
There
you go.
I live to surprise you. Well, I'm out of cards and gags.
I'd like to sing a song.
Perfect.
That I sang 50 years ago on the Johnny Carson show, and I wasn't in very good voice that night. It was 1968, and I'd like to sing the song the way I really wanted it to be sung. So it's a marvelous Christmas song, and it's all for you. Please
stay with me till after the holidays. That's when I need you so. Just say you'll wait till after the holidays, then I can let you go. Don't make me spend this Christmas alone. After each marvelous Christmas we know, won't you be kind and let me believe you're mine on New Year's Eve? Just stay with me till after the holidays. I know it's hard, but try to pretend till New Year's. Don't make me spend this Christmas alone. After each marvelous Christmas we know, won't you be kind and let me believe you're mine on New Year's Eve? I know this is a very sad Christmas song, but with the state of affairs in this country lately, I really don't think it makes a difference. Please stay with me till after the holidays. I know it's hard, but try to pretend till New Year's. Then we can say goodbye. And that's the way you do it.
That's so morbid. That's the most morbid Christmas song. She actually sang that. Is that right?
Nicely done.
My throat's very a little compromised tonight.
Nicely
I apologize
done.
To the viewers.
Nicely done. Beautiful.
Yes. How did you find that?
It's on YouTube.
Yeah, it's on YouTube.
She does it actually a step lower.
And she does it sitting.
Oh, yeah, she does it.
On the couch.
Yeah, she does. Yeah, beautiful end. Mario, what's up? Plugs.
Well,
but plugs.
Celebrity autobiography.
No, you can't. It's over. That's okay. Over. I don't know.
Coming up?
I have nothing coming up right now.
Stand-up gigs.
No stand-up gigs.
Okay.
I'm reclusive lately.
Okay. What's Jerry doing?
I did do an episode of a Netflix show that's coming on in August, so hold your breath.
Okay, that's a ways off.
Yeah, that is.
Okay.
Jerry is now in Seattle a lot. He goes back and forth a lot. He is the new artistic director of the Village Theater that's in Issaquah and is in Everett that are on either side of Seattle. Sure. And it's a big theater. It's been there
for
25 years. He's the new artistic director. He's directed there off and on for 12 years. So he's there a lot, which I'm not happy about. But he's home a lot because he's a Tony voter. And we've seen everything for free. He's saved me $12,000 just so far.
Will there be another one-man show at some point?
I'm working. I do have producers trying to get it done. We'll see.
Seth, tell us about your work with Why Hunger and Harry Chapin's organization.
Frank. Yeah, Why Hunger is an organization started by Harry Chapin and Bill Ayers in the 1970s, trying to get at the root causes of hunger, which is poverty. If people had enough money, they wouldn't be hungry.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of, there are many great organizations that do a lot of great work in feeding people and getting groceries out and food banks. We're kind of working the other side of the street in the food movement to really get at the root causes, help community farms. We have a hunger hotline where people can call in and find food. So we're great with connecting people to food.
Yeah.
So
give the website.
The website is whyhunger.org, and we're right now in the middle of our Hungerthon campaign, which by the time this is on,
this will be on the 24th.
It goes through the end of the month, but go to whyhunger.org, donate, and help us out and do good things.
Important cause.
Thank you, Frank.
I'm so glad you came.
Me too.
Cantone, what can I say to you?
Oh, I don't know.
I want to thank two people, Michael Dopkins and Krista Rose, who helped with the research for you.
As they should.
Just for you.
I will be back next year when he's replaced. Anybody. I don't care.
Okay, Gil.
Bring Artie Shaw back from the dead and have him swing a band. Something.
This has been Gilbert Gottfried's Amazing Colossal Podcast with my co-host, Frank Santopadre. And our special guest today, as has been with every Christmas, is the man who taught me everything I know about pussy, Mario Cantone.
I did. Before he was married, I was his side man. I got him laid constantly.
Thank you, Mario. Thank you, Seth.
Thank you, Gilbert.
My
love
pleasure.
You.
Thanks
I love you guys.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you so much.
Great to be here. Thanks,
God bless us all.
God bless us, everyone.